After exploring the bordering neighborhoods of Ginza, we're back in the heart of the district to visit some of its oldest establishments. Shops and eateries that have survived calamities, war, and more recently, Japan's bubble economy. Land prices are said to be the highest in Ginza. Many establishments hardly break even because of the cost of rent, but keep their flagship stores anyway for the prestige of an address here. But that hasn't stopped mom-and-pop shops and obscure specialty stores from thriving in Ginza. Local officials, civic leaders, and shopkeepers have come together to keep it this way. They call it the Ginza filter, an unofficial policy that guides a retail mix in the area, ensuring that young and old, high and low, modern and traditional are represented in the streets of Ginza. And thanks to that filter, there are surprises around every corner. We all know by now that Ginza has one of the highest real estate prices in Tokyo, and that explains the high rent in this area. But that doesn't mean you can't find affordable restaurants in this neighborhood. In fact, this restaurant over here, Ginza Byron, has been serving workers since 1927, and they still do. So let's check it out, because it's a Ginza institution. Ginza Byron specializes in one and only one dish, tonkatsu, deep-fried breaded pork cutlet. Over the years, they developed different ways of serving tonkatsu, but the ingredients and techniques used in cooking the pork have hardly changed.
Arigatou gozaimasu. Ginza Byron isn't the first restaurant in Tokyo to serve tonkatsu, but it's the first restaurant to specialize in a deep-fried dish, and that was in 1927. 90 years later, it's still exclusively tonkatsu on the menu. And I like that. I love restaurants that specialize in only one dish, do it really well. So I'm gonna have the classic.
The classic is the original from 90 years ago, sort of. It's deep-fried pork tenderloin, sliced for convenience, over a generous bowl of white rice, with a side of greens and soup. These days, however, the preferred pork is kurobota, a Japanese breed of the Berkshire pig, known for its superior tenderness and quality.
Two things you immediately notice. First is the crispiness of the crust. That's because of a very special flour and batter mix that they have here.
They use a special type of flour with a unique shape of grain that when fried becomes extra crunchy. Oil from the cotton plant is used for frying to keep the crust light and less oily.
Now the second thing you notice is the sauce. Now I've tried tonkatsu in other places. Usually their sauce is salty, a bit on the spicy side, but this one is slightly sweet, and what I love is it's quite fruity as well. It really enhances the dish. Sumimasen. Yes. I want to know more about the sauce.
Original sauce.
Ooh. Okay. So you use fruits, apples, carrots, vegetables.
The manager, Komori-san, tells me the founder was a medical professional and using his experience in the lab, concocted this sauce with fruits, vegetables, vinegar, and a secret ingredient he can't divulge, not on TV at least.
Which is why it's crunchy and crispy. Arigato. Yes, thank you.
Another popular version is a katsu sandwich. It's a recent invention, actually, when bread was introduced as a substitute during a shortage of rice in the post-war years. It has stayed on the menu since. And finally, there's donburi katsudon, tonkatsu topped with a fried egg. A proper dish must have the egg perfectly balanced on top, or you can send it back. Our next specialty shop is Tenshodo along busy Harumidori. They have a fantastic vintage watch department, but we're here for something even more specialized, model train sets.
This is not a toy store. Denshoto has been selling trains to serious collectors since 1949. In fact, some of the train sets here cost as much as 415,000 yen. This gives you a glimpse of the Japanese enthusiasm for collecting very specialized items. And there are many stores like this all throughout Ginza.
The Japanese are among the world's most obsessive model train builders and collectors. But there's a deeper connection with trains than mere nerd-like fascination with them. Stay in Japan long enough and you'll discover the people's faith in their train system. It's a source of national pride, which began during the Meiji period, when locomotives and tracks symbolized modernity in a drive to outdo the West in their own game. For everyone else, however, it's a fun distraction from the luxury shops of Ginza. And you could spend hours going through the provenance and the lifelike details of each train set on display. Beginners will want to start on the lower floor, where prices are cheaper and train sets more common. Even then, the selection here is unbelievable. All over the world, niche collectors and specialty shops have slowly been replaced by online sellers, but not in Ginza. Le Monchat is one of a handful of used and vintage camera stores occupying prime retail space in the area.
I've always wondered why there's so many used camera and vintage camera shops in Ginza. So I asked the store manager and he tells me that Ginza used to be very close to the GHQ of the US Army after World War II. And the American soldiers and the war correspondents would unload their cameras on the black market of Ginza. Well, that explains the practice.
Le Monchat got its name from the term Americans use to describe something broken or unusable. Lemon. Though these vintage cameras are all in working condition. There's a big subculture of analog film enthusiasts and vintage camera collectors in Tokyo. That's what allows shops like Le Monchat to meet the rent.
If you're looking for a Leica rangefinder or a Rolleiflex twin lens reflex camera, you won't be disappointed at Le Monchat. They've got lots of models here. But remember, this is Japan, the country that gave the world the Nikon camera, and they've got lots and lots of amazing models here, like these ones. I love Nikon.
My first serious camera was a manual Nikon back from the 70s, so these have sentimental value to me. The store's Nikon rangefinder selection is amazing, and if you can get your hands on 35mm film, they still ought to take great pictures.
This was a very special camera when it was first released. And it was released in time for the first Tokyo Olympics. Before that, only Western cameras had a motor drive. But Nikon came out with the first motor drive for a Japanese camera. And made history for Japan. Beautiful.
And for 4 million yen, you get a piece of photojournalism history. It's amazing just how many hobby shops still operate in Ginza, including this one specializing in antique Japanese military swords, weapons, and regalia. Ginza Seiudo is the largest seller of antique Japanese swords in the country, with a collection ranging from the samurai of ancient times to those of imperial officers in World War II.
Thank you for showing me this very special sword. He was saying this is a very old and important sword, more than 700 years old. This is the early Kamakura period of Japan, and because of the construction, because of the quality of the blade, it must have been owned by a very, very high-ranking and important samurai. Amazing.
The sword, or katana, was more than a weapon in Japan. It was a symbol of prestige and rank. The better made a blade was, or the craftsmanship of the details, the more important its owner was. But of course, these were primarily built to kill. Forged and sharpened to perfection, they could cut through the enemy's armor. These days, however, swords are kept for their aesthetic beauty and cultural value.
It's now illegal to own a katana in Japan unless you have the right papers for it. Which is why some families who've inherited this heirloom would rather break the sword rather than turn it over to the authorities. This way, it's no longer a sword and they can keep it and display it in their homes.
Since ownership rules are more liberal outside Japan, Seiyudo has a license to ship swords to collectors overseas. Still, there's nothing like holding a genuine samurai sword in your hand. As we've seen, even in modern Ginza, old traditions die hard or coexist easily with a foreign and contemporary. But despite the various upscale restaurants and Western-style cafes, many still prefer the local way. Under the tracks of Yurakucho Station, where Ginza ends, locals flock for late-night bites and beer. No map can take you here, but look for the opening under the elevated tracks and make your way deep inside Yakitori Alley. Little if any English is spoken here, and good luck finding an English menu. So just do as the locals do. Grab a table and order yakitori, skewers of meat, down with lots of beer and sake. If that's a bit too local for you, there are hundreds of restaurants in Ginza offering authentic Japanese food in a traditional surrounding, and with an English menu. Whichever you choose, do as Tokyoites do, and burn off the carbs and walk off the alcohol with some ginbura at night. Better yet, stop by a bar and relive Ginza's golden age before the Second World War.
During the Showa period, people came to Ginza to enjoy Western lifestyle and Western music. This was the epicenter of Tokyo's jazz age. It kind of disappeared in succeeding years, but it's all starting to come back. And we're here to check out one of the newest music bars in the neighborhood. There's this misconception of how Tokyoites unwind after a hard day of work. According to the stereotype, well, they go crazy in some karaoke bar somewhere and fall asleep on the subway going home. Well, maybe in some parts of the city that so happens, but in Ginza, where the crowd is more sophisticated, this is how they relax.
Ginza Music Bar is what the old digs of Ginza used to look like before the more recent invasion of tacky karaoke, cosplay, and girly bars. While most in Tokyo still head to pachinko parlors and izakayas to de-stress, cocktails and live jazz was how their counterparts in the 20s and 30s chose to relax. Instead of a live band, Ginza Music's DJ plays tracks from a collection of more than 3,000 vinyl records.
Turns out this bar is owned by a famous Japanese record producer, Shinichi Osawa. And I guess that explains the fantastic high fidelity system and of course the impeccable choice of music. In fact, you might even recognize one of the records he's produced. Why don't we play this record, Bird? Listen in.
Sitting here with a cocktail in hand and music in the background, I can't help but realize how wrong most people are about Ginza. It's upscale, sure, but far from the mecca for rich middle-aged mothers or boring suits that many make it out to be. Over a long period of time after the Meiji period, Ginza was the coolest place to be, for artists and intellectuals in the 30s, and even for John and Yoko in the 1970s. Other districts in Tokyo have now overtaken Ginza in coolness, but none offer the sheer variety of experiences, retail choices, and ability to walk as aimlessly in Ginbura fashion as Ginza can.
And that's all for this episode of Executive Class. I'm David Saldran. Thanks for watching.